Hi everybody, so welcome back. And now that you have a little bit of an introduction to the built environment, we're going to talk about how it directly impacts physical activity. So as you probably all well know, some of the leading causes of death are linked back to obesity and obesity-related chronic diseases. At least obesity increases the risk for developing some of the leading causes of death in the United States. And is obesity getting better as a whole? Absolutely not. We've seen that over the years, the trend in the amount of adults in the United States who are considered obese, as defined by having a body mass index over 30, has been steadily increasing state by state. If you want to have a little bit more of a, this is from 2014, so not quite as recent as I'd like for it to be, but if you want to look at the obesity rates by state in 2014, here you go. And we know, and especially you guys know, seeing that you are experts in exercise and wellness and nutrition, you know that the very basic equation is energy in and energy out equals your risk of increasing weight, right? Where if you are consuming more calories and you're burning less, that's that physical activity and exercise piece, you're increasing your weight. And so one thing that public health scholars, public health practitioners, governmental practitioners, or governmental entities, healthcare practitioners are really becoming a little bit more interested in is in what ways can we change something about the built environment to really increase physical activity in an age where in an age and in a culture where being sedentary is becoming the new norm, and one out of every four adults is basically living a fully sedent a life that's void of physical activity. How can we help adults reach the US physical activity guidelines as defined by what you see on the screen here? So again, public health practitioners and different entities are becoming more interested in how do you change the built environment around people, particularly looking at urban design, and how do you increase resources that will increase the likelihood that people can be physically active where they live, work, and play? Oh, we're not going to talk necessarily so much about social capital, but by having neighborhoods that that feel safe, that feel like it's a safe place to walk, to be, and by having people become more physically active, you not only enhance the perceived safety, but you also increase interpersonal trust, and the likelihood that people will convene outdoors. So again, focusing on how to create more active cities, here are just some recommendations, and we'll go through more so in points one through three about how to create a more active city. One is develop and maintain mixed land use. We'll talk about what that means. Improve transit and transit facilities and other resources aimed at helping people become more physically active in their communities. And then design what we'll hear is called complete streets, but more pedestrian friendly, commuter friendly, that's not necessarily focusing on a car to commute, streets with high connectivity. So again, going back to point one, mixed land use. If we were to ask, what exactly is mixed land use? It's basically when you combine residential with business and recreational use of different types of property, and as well as zoning for residential and zoning for business-related activities, to combine them into a neighborhood that's got both, again, business opportunity, restaurants, places to go shopping, banks, things that people use on a day-to-day basis with where you live. And that really encourages people to become more active in the places where they live. We also want to improve transit. Downtown Phoenix has been doing a really great job of trying to create an environment that increases physical activity between how connective our streets are and being placed on a grid. Is one way to increase that connectivity. We'll talk about that in an upcoming slide. Having more reliable forms of public transportation, such as our bus system and our Metro Rail, and then also including things such as the Green Bike program that we have that offers a mode of very affordable transportation for people to be able to kind of pick up and drop off these bikes, and instead of relying on a car to get from place to place, really relying on renting these publicly available, if you've got a membership, bike to get from point A to point B downtown. Also to kind of mention, the streets of downtown Phoenix, for the most part, the sidewalks are, you know, wide enough to be able to walk safely. There's a fair share of lighting, which I don't know about you guys, but I feel pretty safe walking around most parts of downtown. So again, downtown Phoenix really has come a long way, especially from what I've heard of what the downtown area was like, you know, 10, 15 years ago. It's really become a place where young professionals and business people and business owners and a whole host of different communities can, you know, live and thrive, you know, work and play and be physically active in getting to and from the various locations downtown. So we talked about, you know, briefly about, you know, making streets, making neighborhoods a bit more walkable. Well, what does that entail? If you see, this is a picture on the top part, and well, both pictures really show a walkable area. You'll see that wide sidewalks where more than one or two people can walk enhances the walkability and encourages people to really use that as, you know, a way of getting from point A to point B. Including crosswalks and safe areas for people to safely cross the street. Increasing lighting so that at nighttime when it gets dark or early in the morning when it's dark, people feel safe that they're in a well-lit area. One thing that enhances people's likelihood of being physically active outdoors is seeing other people on the street, knowing that it's safe. Also increasing green space, which, and especially in Phoenix, shade, because we all know that in the summertime here, when it gets to be 110, 115, 120 degrees Fahrenheit, that there could be a 20 degree difference between, you know, a shaded area and an area with no shade. That's one way of really trying to enhance the likelihood of people walking from, you know, from place to place downtown. So again, including speed bumps so that traffic has to slow is one way to enhance the walkability of certain areas. So creating more connected streets, increasing connectivity is one way to increase people's likelihood of walking in a neighborhood. In this graphic that you see, the top part of the picture really shows how interconnected streets are. So if you needed to get from, you know, point A to point B, you've got a lot of different options for how to get there. In this neighborhood, in the picture below, on the same graphic, but the, you know, second bottom half of the picture, you see what's more characteristic of areas that have sprawl, where there really are limited options and limited ways to get from point A to point B. And so this type of, you know, built environment or urban design really increases the likelihood of you using cars to more quickly get to where you're trying to go. So the top half of the picture really is more pedestrian friendly. The bottom half of the picture is really meant more for car-based society. Just something that's really interesting, if you ever want to check it out, there's something called Walk Score, which you can type places where you're thinking of moving or living or just wanted to see how walkable certain neighborhoods are. And it will give you a walk score. And the higher the walk score, the better. You want to get closer to 100 as opposed to zero. That tells you, are there businesses worth walking to? Are there restaurants worth walking to? How safe is the area? You know, is there more concentration of cars? You know, how are the sidewalks? Are there, you know, other things that are put into place, other elements of the built environment that make that community more walkable to try to reduce sedentary behavior and increase physical activity? So next up, I want to give you a couple of examples of different ways that people have altered the built environment. So changed something about urban design or even just rethought the way that certain built environments have already existed to try to engage people in being more physically active and be also more engaged in being outdoors in those areas. So the first example I want to give you is in New York. It's called the High Line. It was a former railroad that existed about 30 feet above the streets, and it's where there was an above ground railroad that cargo was brought in and out to and from Manhattan. Well, the last train actually traveled on that railroad in 1980, and in the late 90s, early 2000s, there was a discussion of potentially tearing down the High Line because it was no longer serving its purpose. Well, there were two individuals who decided, no, don't tear it down. That's going to be expensive to tear it down. We could actually do something with it. It will take some initial investment, but maybe we could have this pedestrian walkway and, public park where people can get from point A to point B without having to worry about traffic and crossing streets to navigate certain parts of New York City. And that's exactly what they did. So a group called Friends of the High Line was formed, and they were basically the planning group that worked with other city planners and other entities to really try to get this project up and off the ground. And lo and behold, it was built. It's got over a mile and a half worth of a walkway that again was a former railroad that was just revitalized, rethought through, and created into a public park. They've planted different plants and trees and included benches. They also have different forms of exercise, such as yoga, different cooking classes and cooking demonstrations, as well as businesses, pop-ups that have set up shop in order to make this public park, kind of more of that mixed land use of both a park as well as having different business entities to again encourage people to use it. And it's been quite a success. So I also want to show you something that's been going on in Phoenix that has been aimed at increasing the walkability of certain areas of the city. So I'm pulling that up right now.
This is a street in Phoenix today, designed for cars, not for pedestrians or cyclists. And this is what that street can be transformed into. They're called complete streets and are intentionally designed to ensure safe, welcoming access for pedestrians, cyclists, motorists, and public transit riders. A complete streets policy for Phoenix would mean better neighborhoods, improved quality of life, an overall increase in safety and health, and enhanced economic growth. Complete streets are for everyone.
If you ask Arizonans what matters to them, many of them will say the interaction with the outdoors, the ability to enjoy the weather, and to participate in both cultural and physical activity.
I ran for mayor as a strong proponent of bikeability, walkability, public transportation. To be a truly a great city, you have to be multimodal and adopting complete streets and then acting on it. That's not just adopting it, but making sure that we actually bring it to life and implement the policies that are in the proposal is what's going to make our city more competitive moving forward.
St. Luke's Health Initiatives, an organization whose mission is to inform and connect efforts to improve the health of individuals and communities in our state, has put its full support behind a complete streets policy for Phoenix because this is a health asset literally right under our feet. And Phoenix is not alone. Many other U.S. cities have already made the choice to redefine their neighborhoods and communities with complete streets, making things more convenient, accessible, comfortable, and safe for everyone. Phoenix is next in line to adopt a policy, which really is a major cultural shift from moving cars well to moving all people and connecting places well. That would greatly benefit the city on so many levels, starting with preventing pedestrian and cyclist injuries, through to economic development and improving air quality.
The built environment has a profound effect on health, and when you pay attention to that aspect of it, you start to realize that when we engineer streets to move cars, that could be detrimental to health, and often is. What the policy says essentially is that you're going to be building complete streets as you build new streets, and that you need to look at creating complete streets anytime you touch an already built street. Right now, what you're seeing, if you look in downtown Phoenix, you'll see a couple of instances where paint is being used to show what it would look like, because paint's, relatively speaking, cheap, much cheaper than moving concrete. So you put the paint down, you put in some temporary planters, you get a feel for what it's like, and then you start to gain an appetite amongst the citizens and council and city staff for how this could make the city a better place, and then you start to see the investments and the shifts in budgets towards concrete and permanence.
The many elements of a complete street include bikeways and bike lanes, business front porches, parklets, shaded sidewalks, pedestrian islands, dedicated bus lanes, frequent and safe crossing options, as well as creative landscaping and unique street furniture.
The community, small business, the city, neighborhood leaders are ready for this, and that we want a complete street system because we know it makes for better neighborhoods.
It may be cooler, it's more economically alive, it's easier for people to participate and to use other forms rather than just being in a car driving.
When we do adopt a complete streets policy, I can't wait, because it does send a message that we are truly going to become a multimodal city. We're going to be car friendly, we're going to be bus friendly, we're going to be light rail friendly, bus rapid transit, and we're going to be walker friendly as well.
And that policy adoption marks a critical first step in Phoenix's path toward a healthier, more enjoyable, more vibrant city than ever before.
Right? Okay. So there's also another plan that's aimed at increasing, as we, again, kind of briefly having mentioned this in earlier slides, it can get really deeply hot here, and the difference in temperature can drastically change by having more shade, by having more tree canopy. So another plan that really took a lot of, policy change was to try to increase tree canopy from 10%, which is what it currently has, to 25% by 2030. So by having more shade downtown and in other parts of the city, we kind of help make it a little bit cooler, especially during the summer, to try to encourage people to be more physically active, to actually, again, walk from point A to point B instead of using your car. So be more physically active, but also enhance environmental health here in the Valley. So if you're interested in any of this information, I'd highly recommend checking out these local groups and initiatives, as well as check out the High Line. Go online, go on YouTube, and learn a little bit more about the High Line. I know if ever I go to New York City anytime soon, I definitely want to take a walk on that, because I think it's such an innovative idea and such a great use of something no longer in service to try to connect communities as well as help people become more physically active. So that's all I have for this set of slides. Stay tuned for the next set of slides, or the next discussion on housing and how that impacts health and well-being.